When President Trump won his first term, it was a little hectic when he put together his cabinet and his administration. He was an outsider to Washington, D.C., so he didn't know the ins and outs or who he could trust. This time, things are a lot different. It's going a lot faster and smoother, and he's putting together a powerhouse team for his second term. Here's what we know so far about the administration. For the director of the CIA, Donald Trump named John Ratcliffe. So for those of you unfamiliar, John Ratcliffe is a lawyer, and he also has experience as director of national intelligence. He is who you see here on screen left.
The approximately 50,000 text messages that I've seen with your personal beliefs like F Trump, stop Trump, impeach Trump. Go ahead and confirm on the record that none of that occurred on an official FBI device or on official FBI time. Go ahead and do that.
Sir, no, they did. Many of them did.
Oh, they did. Okay,
so 50,000, sir.
So really, no, I'll give you a chance at the end. So what you really meant to say was that when you said you never crossed that bright, inviolable line, what you meant to say was, except for 50,000 times, except for hundreds of times a day where I went back and forth expressing my personal opinions about effing Trump and stopping Trump and impeaching Trump on official FBI phones, on official FBI time. Other than that, you never crossed that line. I'm sure there are 13,000 FBI agents out there that are beaming with pride at how clearly you've drawn that line. Agent Strucker, you're starting to understand why some folks out there don't believe a word you say, and why it's especially troubling that you, of all people, are at the center of the three highest profile investigations in recent times that involved President Trump, and that you were in charge of an investigation investigating, gathering evidence against Donald Trump, a subject that you hated, that you wanted to F him, to stop him, to impeach him. And do you see why that might call into question everything you've touched on all of those investigations? Chairman, I'm done with this witness and I yield back.
Now, out of everyone that Trump has named to his administration so far, John Ratcliffe has gotten the best reception that I've seen online. It's near universal praise and excitement, especially from people on the right, from people who voted for Trump. So that's really exciting to see. Up next is Elise Stefanik as ambassador to the United Nations. Now, in case you're not familiar with her, she is a congresswoman from New York. Earlier this year, when protests were happening on universities and college campuses nationwide after the October 7th attacks, Elise Stefanik called in the presidents of three Ivy League universities, and they ended up resigning. So a lot of people actually credit Elise Stefanik for single-handedly getting rid of three woke DEI Ivy League university presidents, and here is a clip from that questioning.
At Penn, does calling for the genocide of Jews violate Penn's rules or code of conduct? Yes or no?
If the speech turns into conduct, it can be harassment, yes.
I am asking, specifically calling for the genocide of Jews, does that constitute bullying or harassment?
If the speech if the speech becomes conduct, it can be harassment, yes.
Conduct meaning committing the act of genocide? The answer is yes. And Dr. Gay, at Harvard, does calling for the genocide of Jews violate Harvard's rules of bullying and harassment, yes or no?
It can be, depending on the context.
What's the context?
Targeted as an individual, targeted as, at an individual.
It's targeted at Jewish students, Jewish individuals. I will ask you one more time. Does calling for the genocide of Jews violate Harvard's rules of bullying and harassment, yes or no?
Anti-Semitic rhetoric.
And is it anti-Semitic rhetoric?
Anti-Semitic rhetoric when it crosses into conduct that amounts to bullying, harassment, intimidation, that is actionable conduct and we do take action.
So the answer is yes, that calling for the genocide of Jews violates Harvard code of conduct, correct?
Again, it depends on the context.
It does not depend on the context. The answer is yes, and this is why you should resign. These are unacceptable answers across the board.
Now, I just love the moral clarity that Elise Stefanik has, and I believe she'll bring that to the United Nations to make sure that we put America's interests first on the global stage. Now, Donald Trump has named Lee Zeldin as head of the EPA. His main priority on day one is to turn back regulations that stifle energy and American innovation and growth. But what I love about this, the way the mainstream media is covering this, is they accidentally admitted that the Inflation Reduction Act that Joe Biden passed and forced through actually has very little to do with inflation and is actually the Green New Deal in disguise. Here's how they covered Lee Zeldin's appointment.
Zeldin was, I think, as your reporting showed, a somewhat unusual pick. He's not someone that has shown a lot of interest or expertise in the climate. But one of the major initiatives we know he will likely undertake is what Donald Trump has said all along, that he wants to undo Biden's signature environmental law, the Inflation Reduction Act, which plowed hundreds of billions of dollars into this green energy transition. If Trump has the Senate and likely the House, how likely is it that Lee Zeldin and Trump will be able to undo that act?
So it's interesting. President-elect Trump has been really clear. He wants to undo or repeal the IRA, as you said, Biden's signature climate law, historic climate law. But that's not something that can be done with executive authority. The president can't just say, make the law go away. He will need both chambers of Congress. And even then, you know, even with the Republican majority in both chambers of Congress, it's not entirely certain.
While it is true that Donald Trump can't single-handedly roll things back like the Inflation Reduction Act, which again is just the Green New Deal in disguise, he can overturn some of those regulations through executive orders and actions. One of the best examples of this is the CPP, which is the Clean Power Plan. That was put into place by Barack Obama. In his first term, Donald Trump took executive action to overturn some of those regulations. Joe Biden put those regulations back into place again through executive action. So Donald Trump can do that again in his second term. So what they said there isn't entirely accurate. Up next is the Secretary of Defense, and that goes to Pete Hegseth. Now, what I love this is that Pete personally has served in the military, which is awesome. And by the way, he is also on Fox News, and this is the moment that Fox News broke the news to their audience.
That our own Pete Hegseth will be his Secretary of Defense. Pete, of course, has been a host here at Fox for a number of years. He's an Army veteran where he served in Afghanistan, in Iraq. Trump saying, quote, Pete has spent his entire life as a warrior for the troops and for the country. He's tough, smart, and a true believer in America first. With Pete at the helm, America's enemies are on notice. Our military will be great again, and America will never back down. Wow, that is pretty cool. Gosh, we're gonna miss him at Fox, but that's a gain for the country.
Now, those are the only cabinet and administration members we know so far. Of course, there's also J.D. Vance as the vice president and Susie Wiles as chief of staff, which, by the way, a very historic pick, a strong woman for all those people out there like Mark Cuban, who says that Donald Trump doesn't like women. But I digress. Now, despite all of those being confirmed, there are still two rumors out there going around. The first rumor is Marco Rubio as Secretary of State. Now, that rumor has been met with mixed reactions. Some people love the idea, and then other people, of course the left hates it, but other people who are more libertarian are a little iffy on it. I know Ron Paul, for example, put a video out today sort of alarmed at the pick. So it'll be interesting to see if Trump goes through with this or if he listens to the naysayers, but it's still very early. Time will tell. But this is actually Marco Rubio last year.
Senator Rubio, will you call for ceasefire in Gaza?
On the contrary.
Senator Rubio,
are you filming it? So I want you guys to get this. I want them to destroy every element of Hamas they can get their hands on. These people are vicious animals who did horrifying crimes. And I hope you guys post that.
And what about the civilians that are being killed every day?
Hamas should stop hiding behind civilians, putting civilians in the way. Hamas knew that this was going to lead to this. So Hamas should stop building their military installations underneath hospitals.
So you don't care that 15,000 have died? You don't care about the babies that are being killed every day?
I think it's horrifying. I think it's terrible. And I think Hamas is 100% to blame. That's what I think. Make sure you post that, please.
The other speculation out there is Kristi Noem as Department of Homeland Security Secretary. This is her on CNN with Dana Bash.
Can I had almost 10 million people come into our country, and we've got a lot of people that have been on the terrorist watch list, dangerous criminals that are coming into the United States who do not love us, that we're allowing to enter our country. It's an unsafe situation, and the president can be the one who stands up and shows leadership at this time. Change your policies, build a wall, secure the border.
Governor, President Biden is negotiating.
We don't
want to do any of
one to do the other.
He's negotiating because this is what Republicans wanted him to do. So, again, why not take the W?
Why not take the
win?
What has he done? What has he done? He's done nothing as far as actual policies and actually using the tools that he has. I sat 2 days ago with people that work for him that said this president is tying our hands every single day. He does not let us do our job. This president, we work for him, we work for the federal government, and we hate it. We hate our jobs and we hate what's happening to this country because he will not keep us safe.
Again, there are lots of reasons why the immigration system is completely broken. One of them is that the United States Congress, which is supposed to make the laws of the land, has been completely frozen on this for decades. Governor, thank you so much and for coming on and talking about this very important issue. Appreciate it.
Now, I actually really like the first four that Donald Trump has named to his cabinet. I know a lot of people are upset or worried about Marco Rubio, but I am okay with him and I actually like him in that position. The one that I am lukewarm and unsure about is Kristi Noem, but you know, that's just me. I would love to hear everyone's takes on this. What do you think about who Trump has named so far, and what do you think about these rumors? Do you hope the rumors are true? Are you hoping that Trump goes another direction? Let me know down in the comments below. Now, we have two more things to get to. I know it's been crazy in the US. We've been so focused on the election, on what Trump's first 100 days will look like, how we're going to get from here to Inauguration Day. I mean, that seems like a marathon away, even though it's just right around the corner. Well, over in the UK, they have named Kemi Badenoch, I believe I'm pronouncing that right, as head of the Tory party, which is their conservative party, and she actually is trying to hold the UK parliament accountable and could be a very strong ally for the US and Donald Trump.
And so I would like to start by congratulating President-elect Trump on his impressive victory this morning. The Prime Minister and the Foreign Secretary met him in September. Did the Foreign Secretary take that opportunity to apologise for making derogatory and scatological references, including, and I quote, "Trump is not only a woman-hating, neo-Nazi sympathising sociopath, he is also a profound threat to the international order." And if he did not apologise, will the Prime Minister do so now on his behalf?
The Foreign Secretary and I did meet President-elect Trump just a few weeks ago for dinner for about a couple of hours, and we discussed a number of issues of global significance. It was a very constructive exercise.
Mr. Speaker, the Prime Minister did not distance himself from the remarks made by the Foreign Secretary, and I'm very sure that President Trump will soon be calling to thank him for sending all of those North London Labour activists to campaign for his opponent.
Now, the last story I want to talk about today is Joe Biden was in the Oval Office and he was about to speak and reporters were in the room and a Jewish reporter actually asked him a question, and instead of answering the question, Joe Biden got very testy with her. According to the New York Post, Joe Biden snaps at Israeli reporter in latest terse moment with media. Think you can keep from getting hit in the head by a camera behind you? Now, the way that sentence is written, it makes it seem like it was very cogent, right? It makes it seem like it was one thought. But the way he says it, he actually seems to self-correct mid-thought, mid-sentence. Here's what this moment sounded like with the Israeli reporter.
President Biden, do you think that you can get a hostage deal by the end of your term?
Think you can keep getting hit in the head by a camera behind you? All right. Thank you all.
I mean, I'm just saying, if Donald Trump did something like that, if he spoke to a reporter that way, the media would be covering it breathlessly. Oh, Donald Trump is threatening the free press. Oh, Donald Trump is a threat to democracy. They'd be freaking out. Yet Joe Biden can use this sort of rhetoric, language, and disrespect all the time, and no one on the left blinks an eye. But as always, all of this is my analysis, commentary. This is what's going on in the world of politics from my point of view, and I would love to hear from you. Again, what do you think about these cabinet cabinet and administration picks so far, about the ones that we do know for a fact, as well as the rumors. I'd love to hear everyone's opinions and your thoughts on this. If there's anything that you would like me to cover, please let me know. I've been trying to get to requests as I can, especially those who I get a lot of comments from. So just let me know in the comments below. If you haven't already, please be sure to give me a thumbs up. I know it's a simple thing to ask for, but it really does help me reach more viewers like you. My goal is to reach 100,000 subscribers by the new year, and to celebrate, if and when we get there, I will introduce you to my dog, as well as my tuxedo cat, who is very handsome, out in the other room somewhere. I think probably playing with one of his toys, if I had to guess. But I can't wait to introduce you to both of them, tell you their adoption stories, and share the cutest videos with y'all. And of course, we'll also celebrate that milestone by celebrating some of you. So be sure to smash that subscribe button and to check out one of these videos.